you so much. And I'll be speaking on MRI of the knee. I would like to acknowledge my co-author on this, Dr. Anupama Patil, who's a musculoskeletal radiologist, and she's been kind enough to help me borrow a couple of her images for preparation of this talk. So the knee in itself, as we've heard from the previous two talks, is not just the joint per se, but a lot of the structures that cover this. So it's all within the joint, and what surrounds the joint is what makes it so important. And there are a variety of reasons, both intra-articular as well as peri-articular, which help in or which lead to causative factors of all these pain and other issues, which then need to be sorted out. So why do we need an MRI scan? What's the whole purpose of doing an MRI scan? And I think the most important thing is that the MRI scan will give you excellent soft tissue resolution and will allow you very good assessment of the intra-articular structures. What's also very important here is that it will allow you a multi-planar capability, so you can image it in various planes. It does not give ionizing radiation, unlike the CT or the X-rays, and that's the reason why MRIs probably have been very popular in looking at various knee pathologies. Since all the MR scans are probably done by very well-trained technicians and do not involve, results that are dependent upon the positioning, they tend to be very reproducible. So unlike X-rays, where you can have five different radiographers give five different true lateral films, which will then lead to different interpretations, that is not so likely in MR scans. They are more dependent upon the equipment that you use, the resolution that it has, which will then affect the results. So we need to do an EMR because soft tissue structures are as important as bony structures. Probably in no other joint do you find a myriad of problems coming through various soft tissue problems as what we see in the knee joint. These soft tissue structures give rise or give the stability of the knee joint. And once we have an unstable knee, it leads to a variety of problems resulting in a variety of different pathological situations. Also, most of these intra-articular structures are not seen by an ultrasound or a CT, which again makes it very important to look at the knee joint, like possibly a third eye of the surgeon with good differentiation possibilities. So that's why we feel that especially with knee pathology, the MR scan will grossly outweigh the advantages given by an X-ray, a CT, or an ultrasound. Though this is not to belittle any of these other three modalities, these are in itself very important, but I think the MR scores all over them. So how do you perform a knee MR scan? And just some very basic principles. You have an MR gantry, which is a large little bore through which the patient's knee is inserted. You have a dedicated knee coil. That's really important because it tends to focus the energy of the MR scan, giving rise to high resolution. And then the knee is positioned in about 10 degrees of flexion, which allows the whole knee to be relaxed while this procedure goes on for about close to about half an hour or so. We use a high field strength magnet. It should be a minimum of 1.5 Tesla. 3 Tesla scans are, of course, more preferred. You should have a dedicated knee coil, as what we discussed. You should do multiple sequences in all the three planes, and these sequences and these multiple planes will help give you what is called as a 3D thin sectioning, in which you can collate all these sequences and planes and have three-dimensional thin section imaging. This becomes very important, especially if you are looking at things like the menisci, which then allow you to enable you to come to a good diagnosis. This MR scan can then be facilitated to you look at specific things such as doing cartilage mapping or to move the knee while the scan is being done, which is called as a porto knee testing device MR exam. So if you look at the basics, then what do we need to understand? If you look at an MR report, there are certain numbers and there are certain specific terminologies that are used. The radiologist will talk about intensity. And essentially what we mean by intensity is that everything is compared to muscle. So a high intensity signal looks white, an intermediate signal is gray, and a low intensity signal means black. Also, we look at the appearance. So when we say a structure is hyper intense, it means that it's looking more bright than what it should be. So maybe there's fluid in it, there's edema within it. It is iso-intense, which means that it's the same brightness as what we are comparing it with, or it may be hypo-intense, which means if there is loss of vascularity there, there's decreased water content, then it starts looking darker than what it normally should be. A variety of images are then used, or sequences are used. The most popular of them are the T1, T2, and the proton density weighted images. The T1 probably is the most anatomic of all the images and is done in almost all MR scans. When looking at T1, the fluid appears black, muscle appears gray, and fat appears white. And this is probably the most important aspect. When we shift to a T2, then the fluid, which is low intensity and black, turns white. And that's where we use it as a differentiating facilitator here. If you see a difference between the T1 and the T2, we can then find out as to what is happening exactly in relation to the same. What we also look at are the PD weighted images, or the proton density weighted images. And these are the intermediate between T1 and T2. And their basic use is to distinguish between fluid, hyaline, and fibrocartilage. So when you're doing a PD weighted image, fluid, which is the joint fluid, will be high intensity and white. Muscle will always stay gray, no matter whether you use T1, T2, or PD weighted images. Fat will stay black. And now the beauty that we have is that the hyaline cartilage will turn gray and the fibrocartilage will turn black. So that's where we use a PD weighted images, especially for looking at cartilage sequences. We also use fat suppressed images, and these are tweaking of the T1 images. So the bright signal of the fat is suppressed. And then if the tissue which is bright on T1 becomes dark, it will help you detect edema. And I'll sort of discuss that with a few examples as we move along in this particular talk. So the basis that we need to look at when we look at MR scans is to look at the intra-articular structures. You want to look at the ACL, the PCL, the menisci, the collaterals. You want to look at the patellofemoral joint. And then depending upon the pathology, you can then look at, you know, IV contrast sequences, or you can do a post-operative imaging with the previous MR scan, which is very important, where you have to share the patient's clinical history, diagnosis, and the details. So what films should you be looking at? And the first film that we always look at is the T2, in which, as I said, the fluid looks bright and white. Most of the structures look black. Muscle will always look gray. And if there's anything pathological, it will always look white. You're going to be doing imaging in all the three planes, namely the sagittal plane, which goes from front to back, the coronal plane, which goes from medial to lateral, and you have the axial or the transverse plane as well. And these are the representative images of all the three different planes, in which you will find that varying parts of the knee joint get exposed and they reveal themselves in the varying sort of different planes that we use. So let's look at what's normal. And we'll first start with the ACL. So the ACL is a flat ribbon-like structure which starts from the tibia. It starts from the intercondylar area of the tibia anteriorly and extends right back to the back of the lateral femoral condyle, and the posteriormost fibers of the ACL will blend with the periosteum on the posterior aspect of the knee. The ACL exhibits different tensioning patterns. So the fibers which are inserted on the anteromedial aspect of the tibia will become taut as your knee starts going into towards 90 degrees of flexion. And the fibers which originate from the posterolateral aspect of the tibia will become taut as the knee starts going into full extension. So based on the same, you will have different tensioning patterns for the AM bundle as well as the PL bundle. And again, I repeat, as we start going into full extension, you'll find that certain fibers become taut, and when we go start going towards extension, the other bunch of fibers become taut. The ACL again is composed of two sets of fibers based on the tibial insertion. You have the anteromedial fibers and the posterolateral fibers, which insert the respective locations on the femoral side. The footprint of the ACL on the tibial side is usually larger than that on the femoral side. It measures approximately in Indian people from anywhere between 8 to 12 millimeters in width and approximately around 14 to 20 millimeters in length. On the femoral side, all the fibers are inserted in an area which is below the lateral intercondylar ridge. My hook probe is palpating the intercondylar ridge, and what you can see there is the remnant of the fibers of the femoral insertion of the ACL. Please note that these fibers extend way far posterior, almost up to the posterior periosteum of the posterior lateral condyle of the femur. As I said, the length of the femoral footprint is usually less than that of the tibial footprint. And in the same patient, we find that when the tibial footprint was measuring around 16 millimeters, the femoral footprint measures about 12 to 13 millimeters. And this is a standard finding in almost all the knees that we examine. How does the ACL look? The ACL looks as an isointense signal, best appreciated on the sagittal film, because that's how we are used to seeing it. And when you do an oblique sagittal plane, then you can see the entirety of the ACL, because note that the sagittal plane goes straight from anterior to posterior, but the ACL actually starts anteromedially and finishes posterolaterally. So in a sagittal plane, you will see the ACL as a flat isointense structure with a taut sharp margin. On the coronal film, you will see the ACL inserting on to the intercondylar wall of the lateral femoral condyle, and that's how you would see both of them. When you look at an ACL on the T2 sagittal image, because it goes from anteromedial to posterolateral, you will find that with subsequent sagittal images, the entire ACL comes into more view. So the extreme left picture is a lateral sagittal view, and the extreme right is a medial sagittal film. And you can see that you can look at the whole ACL when as it courses through the same. On the PD fat sat image, the same intensity can be observed very nicely. And here, because we've changed the intensity of the signal, the whole ACL starts looking a lot more better. In the coronal plane, as we move from front to back of the knee, you can trace the ACL right up to its insertion on the posterolateral femoral condyle in the intercondylar notch. And that is useful when we do our look at MR scans of our patients. Similarly, in the axial view, as you come down, you can see that the ACL is inserted properly on the intercondylar notch as we start moving in deep. So it's important to study various sections. And then based on those sections, you can start tracing out your ligaments or your structures, which will enable you to come to a proper diagnosis. What about the PCL? The PCL is again composed of two strong fibers. We have the anterolateral fibers, which are so-called named because of their insertion point. And then we have the posteromedial fibers, which are also named as per their insertion. The posteromedial fibers become taut in extension, as what you can see now. These are the posteromedial fibers right there. And the anterolateral fibers, which are the vertical fibers, become taut at 90 degrees of flexion, which is what we examine when we do a posterior drawer test. So these fibers which are taut are the anterolateral fibers, and these fibers that you see low in the notch of the femur are the posteromedial fibers. The PCL will act in unison with the posterior capsule, and the structures of the posterolateral corner of the knee. And this is something which we will discuss as we further move on in our description of various MRI findings. So this is about the PCL, which is very important. The PCL is roughly around 38 to 42 millimeters long. And as we said, it's composed of two sets of bundles, basically based on the insertion of the femur, but distally, they sort of coalesce to form a single indistinguishable insertion point on the upper end of the tibia. The PCL looks like a nice broad band, especially seen well in the mid-sagittal imaging. And then we'll move on to the MCL, which is the next structure that is examined on the medial side. The MCL is composed of a superficial MCL. This superficial MCL is a broad ligamentous structure. It starts about 62 millimeters below the joint line. So the distance of the tibial insertion is 62 millimeters, and the femoral insertion is posterior to that of the medial epicondyle. The white dot is the adductor tubercle, the blue dot is the medial epicondyle, and the green dot is the femoral insertion of the superficial MCL. The medial head of the gastroc inserts onto what is called as the gastroc tubercle, which is the yellow dot, and just anterior and distal to it is the insertion of the second ligament, which is the posterior oblique ligament, or the POL, which moves down onto the tibia to insert near the direct arm of the semimembranosus. So this is the superficial MCL in its entirety. The length or the insertion point below the tibia is around 62 millimeters below the joint line, and then it inserts proximally somewhere, which is proximal and posterior to that of the medial epicondyle. The POL, on the other hand, as we said, originates on the femur near the gastroc tubercle and goes on to insert on the tibia just near the direct arm of the semimembranosus, as what we've shown in this dissection here. The deep MCL consists of two parts, namely the meniscofemoral and the meniscotibial ligament, and these form the third layer of the knee joint. So how do we look? What we see here is layer one. Then we move ahead to layer two, which is the superficial MCL. And then deep inside, we see the layer three, which is essentially the meniscofemoral and the meniscotibial ligament. Again, in the axial section, the blue is layer one, which will be the layer just below the capsule. And then what we have here is layer two, which is the layer of the superficial MCL. On the lateral side of the knee, as we move in, we have the iliotibial band, which is a large muscle tendon structure. And beneath that, we have the long head of the biceps femoris, which has a short head, a long head, and an anterior arm. The biceps femoris is inserted on the tip of the fibula and is a very strong external rotator of the knee joint. Underneath the iliotibial band and the biceps femoris are the three important structures of the posterolateral side of the knee. You have the lateral collateral ligament, which inserts from near the lateral epicondyle and goes to the anterior part of the head of the fibula. It is the primary restraint to varus and also a secondary external rotation restraint at low flexion angles. You have the popliteus muscle tendon unit, which starts in the popliteus sulcus and then courses behind the LCL to go to the back of the knee, which is the primary restraint for external rotation, especially at high flexion angles. And third, we have the structure which is called as the popliteofibular ligament, which starts again from the tip of the fibula, goes to the popliteus tendon, which also serves as a secondary external rotation restraint at high flexion angles. So based upon your clinical examination, you can either have a tear of the lateral collateral or the popliteus, popliteofibular ligament, or all of them together, and this will produce a varying degree of clinical presentations. So when you have abnormal opening, on the lateral side, it constitutes a tear of the lateral collateral ligament. That's a varus stress test. And when you have a tear of the popliteus, you have an abnormal external rotation, which is called as the dial test, which is what we've demonstrated in this clinical examination here. So what do we need to see? We need to ensure that we examine properly the fibular collateral ligament in the coronal plane. You want to examine the popliteus tendon as it inserts in the popliteus sulcus, as it passes behind the meniscus, and as it goes and inserts on the back of the tibia. So it's really important to see the popliteus in its entirety as well. What about the meniscus? We have two menisci, the medial and the lateral menisci. The lateral meniscus has a popliteal hiatus, and all of these menisci are loosely attached to the capsule, except at the insertion on the tibia, which are called as the meniscal roots. The meniscal roots are important because they help in transmission of hoop forces from the knee, from the femur to the tibia. The medial side is concave on convex, but the lateral side is convex on convex, and that's why lateral meniscectomies or lateral meniscus tears have a far higher risk of osteoarthritis. So the menisci in a sagittal plane will appear as a bow tie. When you tie a bow around your neck, this is what is called as a bow tie appearance. And in a coronal plane, they'll appear as dark black triangles, which are within the joint surface or within the confines of the joint, so as to say. Axial sections are very important because the axial sections will show you the menisci as semilunar cartilages, which is what we want to see when we look at our patients, and that's how we understand them the best. Cartilage is again a very complex structure that gets imaged very well on MRI scans. To the left of your screen, you can see normal healthy cartilage of the femur and the tibia. And to the right, you can see a disorganized structure, which is what one would get when you have osteoarthritis. The cartilage is unique because it is anisotropic, it is viscoelastic, and is porous as well. And there is no other structure in the knee in the human body which possesses all of these three qualities. Cartilage, as we are aware, is divided into several layers. You have the superficial tangential layer, you have the calcified zone, and then the subchondral zone. And based on the same, we can observe all of these three zones here. So you can see the gray hyaline cartilage, you can see the black tide mark, and beyond that you have the subchondral bone. So with this differentiation, you can find out how deep is the lesion and what structures does the lesion involve. Bone, as we know very well, is better evaluated with X-rays and CT scans. X-rays are essentially important to look at alignments, osteoarthritis, and fractures. CT scan are very important to delineate finer details of fractures. MR scan is used when we're looking at intraosseous pathology within bone, and the most commonly studied are those of bone marrow lesions, or the BMLs, which we'll come to in our pathological discussion. So what are the things that we normally see? On the sagittal films, we want to look at the ACL, the PCL, the medial meniscus, and the lateral meniscus. In a coronal plane, we want to see the PCL, we want to see the lateral collateral ligament, the biceps femoris tendon, we want to look at the ACL, we want to look at the MCL, which are very important, as well as we will see the medial meniscus and the lateral meniscus. In an axial plane, we want to look at the MPFL, or the medial patellofemoral ligament, you want to look at the MCL, we will be looking at the ACL, the lateral collateral ligament insertion, and the capsule. So this is a gist of the various structures that we will be examining when we come to our next part, where we look at various pathologies and how they appear on MR scans. So to broadly classify, the indications of an MR scan can be divided as traumatic and non-traumatic. The traumatic indications can be osseous injuries or non-osseous injuries, and the non-traumatic indications could be the arthritic painful knee or the non-arthritic painful knee causes, which have been enlisted in the slide in front of you. Technically, to go over the same, it's important to have a good resolution of your MR scan machine, and you need to ensure that you have a dedicated knee coil, which will help you give a good examination. So let's look at traumatic osseous injuries first. And the most important of them are the avulsion fractures. So you have an avulsion fracture of the lateral capsule, which is called as a Sigmoid fracture. This is better seen in on a notch view, where you can appreciate it the most. And this represents an injury to the anterolateral capsule of the knee joint, may or maybe without an avulsion injury of the iliotibial band as well. So this Sigmoid fracture on an MR scan will show up as a flake of bone, and along with it will be attached the anterolateral capsule. Whenever you see a Sigmoid fracture, you have to actively look for the presence of an ACL tear because of a very high correlation of both of these injuries. The next avulsion injury that you will see is that of an ACL avulsion fracture. ACL avulsion fractures, usually more seen in adolescents, are classified into four types depending upon their displacement. They're very well appreciated on X-rays and on CT scans, but an MR scan becomes pretty useful because you can see if the lateral the anterior intermeniscal ligament is entrapped. You can also use your MR scan to make a judgment about the viability of the fragment. Is the fragment viable or is it dead? And it can also help you understand as to whether the ACL tension, is it restored or has the ACL tension been lost, which will then help you plan surgical treatment. On the backside of the knee, you can get a PCL avulsion fracture. These can either be displaced or undisplaced. Again, may not be very well easily appreciable on X-rays unless you look for them, but CT scans will help you understand the displacement very well. The role of an MRI is to really understand whether this requires surgical treatment or not. And what we want to see is to see the tension in the PCL. If the PCL looks nice and taut and there's grade 1 or grade 2 posterior laxity, then these may be conserved. But when the PCL looks completely wavy, such as in this example here, then in those patients, you are better off fixing them because the PCL has lost its normal tension and then needs to be sorted out. You can also look for occult or stress fractures, and we know the etiology for all of them. So all those who are on immunosuppressants, who have osteoporosis and repetitive injuries, can get these stress or occult fractures. You can divide them into two parts. You can have an insufficiency fracture, which is essentially a normal stress on abnormal bone, and that's an osteoarthritic knee with osteoporosis showing the presence of an insufficiency fracture. And those are the same on a sagittal view as well. On the other hand, you can have a stress fracture, which is essentially an abnormal stress on normal bone. So this is a military cadet who has been doing unaccustomed jumping and running exercises, comes with pain at the lower pole of the patella, and you can see the presence of a stress injury here. Please note that the patellar tendon appears to be isointense, so which means that is not injured, but there is definite bone marrow edema. And when you do a T1 and a T2 image, you can easily appreciate that there is the presence of a stress fracture line that is running there. Osteochondral fractures are also not uncommon. They're most common with patellar dislocations, also seen with knee dislocations, which is what you need to appreciate. So when you have a traumatic lateral dislocation of the patella dislocates laterally, and while dislocating, it hits the femoral condyle. And that's where you get the first fracture, which is essentially a fracture of the anterolateral aspect of the lateral femoral condyle. The knee will then dislocate to the lateral gutter. And during the relocation stage, when it gets back in, now the medial patellar facet gets a larger hit, and this produces the loose body or the fragment or the osteochondral fragment of the patellar dislocation, which usually will fall in the lateral gutter. And these are the two small fragments that you will normally get. So this is how you see these osteochondral fractures when you have patellar dislocation. So that's one example. You can see that there's an osteochondral fragment, two of them, better seen on the notch view and on the AP and the lateral views as well. You do a CT scan, you can observe both the fragments sitting right there, exactly coming from the locations that we discussed. A 3D CT of the patella also shows the same. And then when you go to an MR imaging, you can see that the presence of a hemarthrosis will show up very nicely, the displaced fragment in the lateral gutter. It will show you the injury to the MPFL. It will show you the other small patellar facet fracture. It will also show you the large loose body lying within the intercondylar notch. And then we need to decide as to what we do with these fractures. If they are small and non-weight bearing, we can remove them. If they are large with subchondral bone, then we can fix them. If they're large without subchondral bone, we can repair or we can regenerate them is the treatment of choice. So the same patient here, you can see that there's a large osteochondral fragment of the patella. This was retrieved from the lateral gutter. It was sized and placed back in its place. And how do we fix it? We do a biological fixation by creating a healthy bed. We pour some fibrin thrombin glue or tissue glue within the crater. We fix back the fragment and tie it with transosseous vicryl sutures. And after 6 months, we want to ensure that there has been good osteointegration with good restoration of the cartilage surface. And this is possible only on a follow-up MR scan. We next come to traumatic non-osseous injuries. And we first start with ACL tears. So an ACL tear is essentially a clinical diagnosis. The MR scan will help you in just defining morphology. Please don't treat ACL injuries only because the MR scan tells you so. So there are some signs of an ACL tear. You may see a swollen ACL. You can see discontinuity of the fibers of the ACL. You may see discontinuity that comes from the femoral side. You can see detachment of bone from the femoral side. You may see bony avulsions from the tibial side. And you may see what is called as change in ACL angle, which means that the ACL, which was originally supposed to be in this angle, actually has fallen down and is slumped to a slightly lower angle. So these are the basic six primary signs of an ACL tear on MRI scan. It's important that we don't do MR scans very early, because on day one, everything looks really grossly injured. And this is the same patient after 4 to 5 weeks, where an imaging shows us better continuity of the ACL and better details of the ACL tear. Since the ACL runs from anteromedial to posterolateral, it's important to do an imaging in the plane of the ACL. And when you do an oblique sagittal imaging, you're able to observe the continuity of the ACL a lot more better. Similarly, when you do an oblique coronal plane imaging, you're able to appreciate the insertion of both the AM and the PL bundle, and this helps in really delineating the pathology. So here's one example of a patient who had symptomatic ACL laxity. His standard sagittal view shows the presence of an intact ACL, as you can see here, but the patient kept on having instability. And once you image him in a coronal plane, which is that you utilize this plane and do coronal imaging, you can observe that his AM bundle is intact, but his PL bundle is torn. And that's where you can get to know as to where the exact tear is. There are a few secondary signs of an ACL tear. You can get bone contusions. So when you have a bone contusion on the posterolateral aspect of the tibia and the anterolateral aspect of the tibia, it implies that there is a valgus external rotation force. So the patient loads goes into valgus, thereby compressing the lateral side, And when he goes into external rotation, he gets these two bone contusions. If the bone contusion is in the front, it means that he has sustained the ACL rupture by a hyperextension mechanism, which is again very important. If there is a bone bruise on the posterior medial side, it implies a counter-coup injury and also tells us that there is a tear or a separation of the posterior medial meniscus meniscocapsular junction. The second secondary sign is anterior translation of the tibia, more than 7 millimeters. So on a lateral sagittal film, which is going through a lateral compartment, when you see that the tibia is translated anteriorly by more than 7 millimeters, it implies an ACL tear. When you have an uncovered posterior horn of the medial meniscus, when you see a Sigmoid fracture, an arcuate fracture, or when there is buckling of the PCL because of loss of tension in the ACL, all of these are secondary signs of an ACL tear. Coming to the PCL, in acute tears, you will see that the PCL is torn in its mid-substance, but because it has good vascularity, though it is intra-articular, it is extra-synovial, you can get good healing of the PCL, though in an elongated position. So what's important is a thorough clinical examination, and depending upon your posterior drawer, you need, if there is obliteration of the step off, it becomes a grade 2, and then when there is a reverse step off, it becomes a grade 3. So on these aspects, stress x-rays with the knee flexed to 90 degrees are more important, and in this one can really demonstrate the severity of the PCL injury. If you happen to get a reverse step off on an MR scan, it usually implies that there is a very high grade PCL injury and the PLC or the posterolateral corner is more likely to be injured. On the medial side, you need to examine what grade of injury the patient has got. So grade 1 injuries, there's just mild increase in the intensity on the medial side. In grade 2 injuries, the signal is a lot more brighter, but the ligament is still attached to the bone. In grade 3 injuries, it is a full thickness tear, and you can see that the ligament on the medial side is no longer attached to the bone and lies separate from the femur or the tibia based on whether it is a femoral or a tibial sided tear. The posterolateral corner injuries are again quite similar to examine, and here we see that the iliotibial band is intact. The lateral collateral ligament is ruptured completely. The popliteus is also torn, which implies that this is a high grade posterolateral corner injury with injury to both the LCL and the popliteus. When we look at another coronal section going a bit more posterior, you can see again that the popliteus tendon is completely ruptured as it winds around the femur and goes to the posterior aspect of the tibia. Meniscal tears are classified into several types. I don't want to go through all the details of the same, but it's important to understand that meniscus tears do progress. A vertical longitudinal tear will become a complete and then a bucket handle tear. Similarly, a flap tear will then go ahead and lock inside the joint. A oblique tear will become a parrot beak tear. And again, you may have displacement of a vertical longitudinal tear. So meniscal tears are graded as grade 1, 2, and 3 based on their signal. So to the extreme left is a grade 1 injury or a grade 1 signal, which is an intrasubstance signal. A grade 2 is a minor cleft, whereas a grade 3 is a cleft that reaches both the superior and the inferior articular surfaces. However, this alone is not important. We need a lot many details when we're looking at MR scans of meniscus tears. And that's why it's always useful to look at axial sections, because we are used to seeing the meniscus exactly the way we see it in an axial section. So an axial section here will tell you that there is a vertical longitudinal tear of the medial meniscus. It will tell you that there is a complete radial tear, or it will show that there is a complete locked bucket handle medial meniscus tear, all of these which are very well sort of recognized and very well appreciated by all of us. A horizontal cleavage tear is a pattern wherein you will see that the meniscus is split into two horizontally, and this split can be very well seen both on sagittal and coronal films. Very frequently, this split will allow the joint fluid to leak out posteriorly and will form a parameniscal cyst, which is again an important finding that one must pick up. Bucket handle tears are probably the ones that you will get asked most during exams. And besides the one that we discussed on the axial view, on the sagittal film, you need to know what is called as a double PCL sign. The red arrow shows the normal physiological PCL, and the displaced fragment within the notch gives the appearance of two PCLs, or the so-called double PCL sign. A root tear is a tear wherein the meniscus tears from its insertion at the meniscus root, and this will lead to a variety of appearances. You see the detached meniscus root on a radial, on an axial film, you see what is called as the cleft sign. And when you take a section through exactly this particular plane, then in the sagittal film, you will see an intact anterior root, but an absent posterior root, which is called as the ghost sign. So a cleft sign, a ghost sign, and a truncated appearance are all pathognomic of a meniscus root tear. Very quickly, we'll look at non-traumatic causes or indications for doing a knee MRI. You want to look at synovial effusion and differentiate whether it is inflammatory, infective, blood, or lipohemarthrosis. You want to look at cartilage lesions. Cartilage lesions are graded based on the ICRS classification. 0 is normal, 1 is near normal, 2 is slightly abnormal. Usually these will not get picked up very well on MR scans. The grade 3 and the grade 4 lesions, where the depth of the lesion crosses beyond the tide mark into the subchondral bone, are the ones which will produce more clinical symptoms. So this is fissuring of the cartilage or a crab meat appearance, which is seen in grade 2 or grade 3 chondral disease. Again, this shows delamination of the cartilage. This shows a cartilage flap, both of them grade 2, grade 3 ICRS lesions. And this is thinning, again, which will be a grade 2 or grade 3 chondral lesion. So various presentations of grade 2 or grade 3 lesions. And then when we move to grade 4 lesions, you can differentiate. These are coronal sections of the medial tibia. Anteriorly, there is complete loss of cartilage, but posteriorly, there is intact cartilage. So this suggests that this patient has got anteromedial osteoarthritis, where on the medial side, cartilage is deficient anteriorly, but is present posteriorly. Loose bodies, as Dr. Parag did mention, can be of various types. You can have chondral, osteochondral, fibrinous, foreign bodies, retained meniscus fragments, and all of these need to then be imaged on your MR scan, and usually all of them will be in posteriorly within the recess, either the posterior medial recess or in the popliteal recess. Degenerative meniscus tears are again an important cause of arthritic non-traumatic knee pain, and they will be seen as complex injury patterns on your sagittal and your coronal sections. Lastly, we'll come to bone marrow edema or bone marrow lesions. Any alteration of signal of bone marrow, which shows a high signal on T2, a normal or a low signal on T1, or a high signal on proton density with fat pratt separation, is termed as bone marrow edema. Normally, you will find that when you have normal, you have an insult to a normal bone, the bone may get compromised, the bone marrow will set in, and based on the adequacy of the reparative mechanism, you may have either resolution of the insult or you may have bone necrosis. Broadly, bone marrow lesions can be classified as to those not from subchondral bone, for example, infections or tumors, and those which originate from subchondral bone. Those which originate from subchondral bone could either be because of trauma. And we showed that how we can get bone marrow edema patterns when we have an ACL tear. There could be post-operative after you've done cartilage surgery. There could be because of osteoarthritis, because there's a meniscus tear or there's no meniscus and there is bone that is impacting on bone. Or you could have them as a result of insufficiency fractures, which is called as SONG or spontaneous osteonecrosis of the knee. And lastly, you could have AVN. So various bone marrow lesions, and you may be asked the same when you are doing your table vivas during your exams. So it's important to differentiate between AVN and osteonecrosis and SONG, and that is probably one of the spots that you may get asked. Coming lastly to non-arthritic painful knee, which is non-traumatic, you could have myxoid degeneration of your ACL. Please note how the ACL is swollen and appears like a celery stalk, or you could have an ACL ganglion cyst. Here, there is one cyst in the front of the knee, which is blocking extension, and there's another cyst on the back of the ACL, which is blocking flexion. You could have tumors, which are pretty uncommon. So a synovial hemangioma or a synovial sarcoma, or you can have a GCT or a chondrosarcoma, and I won't be going into details of the same. Tumor-like lesions, I think, are more important to look at. The role of MRI essentially is important because it serves as a second diagnostic step. The MR scan will help you differentiate between solid, cystic, and fatty tissue, which is the treatment of choice or the method of choice for doing loco-regional staging. So when you're doing an approach, when you're looking at tumor or tumor-like lesions, you need to answer a couple of questions. Is it intra-articular or extra-articular? And you have the quad tendon, the patellar tendon, and the capsule, which are going to give the limits of your joint. Which compartment is it located? Is it anterior, posterior, or supra or infrapatellar? That's the second thing that you need to answer. Where is it located? Is it intra or extracapsular? Is it intra or extrasynovial? Again, and lastly, on which anatomical structure is it located? And that's how the MR will help you understand as to what type of lesion there is. Synovial chondromatosis is a metaplasia which may produce chondral as well as osteochondral fragments. When they're osteochondral, they may be seen very easily on X-rays, but when they're predominantly cartilaginous, the patient may just present with an effusion and the MR scan will show thousands and millions of these loose bodies. PVNS, again, very common in the knee as compared to other joints. You may have it as a diffuse disease where you see that there is affection of various areas of the knee joint. And when you give IV contrast, all the hemosiderin picks up and looks bright. Or you may have it localized, which mimics a tumor-like lesion and mechanical symptoms. And that was the corresponding arthroscopic image of the same. Last, you have lipoma arborescens. Again, a very specific cause specific to the knee joint. Usually there is metaplasia of the adipose tissue, mainly in the suprapatellar pouch, which produces these frond-like lesions, which can be very pathognomically picked up on MR scans. So to conclude, MR scan is a very useful tool for diagnosis. It can be the third eye of the clinician, but I think it's important that we have to use this tool with caution and interpret this with caution, because we have to treat the patient and not the MR scan, which is, I think, the most important aspect that we need to do. And last but not the least, you have to clinically correlate all of these with the patient's signs and symptoms. Thank you very much.